Blog Talk Radio.
Greetings and welcome to Mystery Babylon News Radio on May 10th, 2015. My co-host tonight is going to be Jörg Glismann from Belgium, and we're going to be discussing some clips from G. Edward Griffin. G. Edward Griffin is an American author, he's a lecturer, and a filmmaker. He is the author of The Creature from Jekyll Island, which promotes conspiracy theories about the Federal Reserve System. Now, tonight's broadcast, like I said, is The Conspiracy of Misdirection. At no time I want you to feel that I am picking on G. Edward Griffin. The point that I want to make is the point that we're going to make in this discussion is it's not what people are saying, it's not what history is telling us, it's what history is not telling us. So with that, I'm going to start the broadcast, and in 8 minutes we'll make a comment. Jörg Glismann from Belgium, and my name is Walt Stickle, your host.
I'm Ed Griffin. I'm a writer. I write controversial works. I think they're very important works. I deal with such topics as banking history, health issues, United Nations, U.S. foreign policy, kind of topics where people get all heated up because they have strong opinions. But I consider myself to be a researcher, and I try to be a historian as best I can. So I deal with facts mostly, not in opinions. I've been doing this most of my adult life. I started becoming interested in issues of this nature in 1959. And by 1960, I was really revved up to it. I left my employment with a large insurance company and went in full-time in doing writing and speaking on these topics. The growth of the Tea Party movement and the left-right paradigm, they're all sort of intertwined, and yet there are very separate intellectual threads that need to be followed in all of that. I think, first of all, it's important to talk about and understand this left-right paradigm. What is this all about? Most of us, including myself for certain, in my younger years, I was brought up thinking that you had to choose, if you were smart at least, you would have to choose politically between being on the right or the left. You had to have a political view. And I thought that in those days, I thought that the extreme right would be something like fascism or Nazism. And on the extreme left, of course, you would have communism or socialism, just a little bit short of that. So that was the paradigm that I was taught, and it seemed to make sense at the time. But as I became more involved in these issues and learned more about them, I began to realize that the basic philosophy between the so-called extreme left people and communists and socialists and the so-called philosophy on the right of the fascists and the Nazis was really the same. How can this be? They're supposed to be opposites of each other. And then I began to realize that there is something more common to all of these philosophies that was left out of my training and education. And that was the ideology of collectivism. Began to realize that the thing that was common to them all is something called collectivism. Now, that's a word that is not very well used. It's not very entrenched in the vocabulary of most people today. But I found out that it was a very commonly used word about a century ago. People wrote a lot about collectivism, and the opposite of that would be individualism. Those are two words that are sort of abandoned today. But in my view, I think they need to be recaptured and understood and used more. And I realized that communism and fascism, the so-called opposites, are merely variants of collectivism. They're the same thing. And they believe that the group is more important than the individual, for example, and the individual must be sacrificed if necessary for the greater good of the greater number. They believe that the state should be all-powerful and that the people should obey the state for the greater good of the greater number and all of that sort of thing. They believe that rights are granted by the state. They're not They're not part of the human being. They're not God-given. They're not entrenched in his body and soul. They have to be granted by the state. All of these things, and you look at them one by one, communists and fascists and Nazis and socialists, they all believe that. So wherein lies the conflict, you see? And I began to question that. And I realized that it's partly a trick. In fact, I think it's a huge trick. It's a great scam because people even today are thinking that they have to choose between the right or the left, not realizing that no matter which way they go, they've accepted basically the same ideology underneath. Now, it's true that the leaders of these groups, like the Stalins of the world and the Adolf Hitlers of the world and the Mao Tse-tungs of the world and so forth, the leaders of these groups on left and right will fight each other. And they will go to war with each other, and there will be tremendous battles, as we saw in World War II, for example. But what are they fighting over? Ideology? Not at all, because they agree on ideology. What they're fighting over is dominance. Who is going to rule? That's all they're fighting over. And once you get that picture historically, it's not too difficult to see that that's the same thing going on even today, as certainly going on in American politics. We have the left versus the right, sort of embodied today in the Republican Party supposedly on the right and the Democrat Party supposedly on the left. Now, here's a choice, isn't there? Well, why is it if this is such a choice that we go from Republicans to Democrats and then 4 years or 8 years later we go back to Republicans again and we keep doing this? We've been doing this since World War I. How come the country keeps moving in the same direction all the time, deeper and deeper and deeper into collectivism, regardless of which party is in favor, because they both believe in collectivism. They both believe in big government. Their slogans are different. Their leaders are different. But the poor voter out there trying to make sense of all this is, he's tricked. He's stuck. He's trapped. And so this is the important thing to, I think, understand, that this left-right paradigm is it's a political ploy. It works very well for those who know what they're doing. We find that the Republican Party and the Democrat Party both are pretty much in the hands of a relatively small group of people with a membership of about 4,000. It's called the Council on Foreign Relations. These are the people that are really pulling the strings in both the Republican and the Democrat Party. And they've even written about it. There's a fellow by the name of Carol Quigley.
Yes, Carol Quigley is a professor at Jesuit Georgetown University. He wrote a book called Tragedy and Hope. It is 1,363 pages. I'm going to give a little quick quiz here, and we'll answer it later on in the broadcast. The question is, how many times was the word Jesuits, plural, used in a book that's 1,363 pages? A, numerous. B, few. C, one. Or D, none. We'll comment on this at the end of this clip.
There's a former history professor at Georgetown University. By the way, he's was the mentor of William Clinton when Clinton was a student there. And he wrote several books about this group of people and their origins and their roots coming from Europe and England in particular. And he comes to a very interesting point in one of his books where he says, okay, this is the way the real world is. He said, how is it that we collectivists, we elitists, how can we rule the world when at the same time we want to let the average person think that they're living in a, quote, democracy? They're living in a system where their vote counts. They're living in this world in which they feel that they must participate in their own political destiny. This is a carefully nurtured myth that they want to create so people will be content with no matter what happens to them. They'll say, well, I voted for it, or I did it. This government is my government. No matter how bad it is, it's responsible to me. And as long as people have that image, then they don't complain so much about how bad it gets because they did it, they think. So Quigley deals with this question, how do you let people think that they're directing their own political destiny when at the same time we, the elite, we are the ones who must direct their political destiny without them knowing it? How do you do that? And he answers the question brilliantly. He said, it's very simple. You've got to have two major political parties And they'll both have the same major goals, the same basic fundamental principles. And they'll argue with each other on the surface with slogans and leadership and style and all of that sort of thing. He said, but we will control them both. There's the strategy. There's the whole scam behind this left-right paradigm. When you understand this history and this reality, you look at it and you say, well, yes, we've got a left wing and a right wing, but they're just opposite wings of the same ugly bird. And that bird is called collectivism.
Greetings and welcome, Jörg Glismann of Hour of the Truth from Belgium. Are you ready for a $64,000 question?
Only 64,000, Walt. I need more.
Well, now, Edward Griffin is a researcher. He's been on Alex Jones, and as you heard in the tape, he went full time, and he was an insurance salesman. But I want to, so he is a. Makes a living of selling books and speaking. But the title of this broadcast, I want to really lay this out so you understand where we're going here. The conspiracy of misdirection. Now, he mentioned Carol Quigley at Georgetown University, but he left out... It's not in their vocabulary. That's Jesuit Georgetown University, founded in 1789, the same year that our country officially became a nation. It was in 1789. The seal for Georgetown University and the seal of the Great Seal of America are so similar. I don't know if George Washington gave the seal to Georgetown or if John Carroll gave the seal to George Washington. But my question to you, York, is how many times do you think in this 1,363-page book was the word Jesuit, plural, mentioned, or the word Jesuit? Okay. Numerous times, B, few, 3, 1, or D, none. What would you guess?
Well, when you know Carol Quigley, you don't even have to read his book to know that the answer is D, none. Because...
Let me correct you now. It was 1.
Okay.
They did mention it one, but you were very close, okay? So I'm not gonna flunk. You didn't flunk the test. So continue, please.
Well, the point is that Carol Quigley himself is Jesuit educated, and people who follow the Jesuit agenda are only allowed to a certain point to expose them. When you go into so-called researchers like Eric John Phelps, for example, who exposes the Jesuits on many levels in his book Vatican Assassins. There's only so much that he can or is allowed to reveal in his book. And when there comes another author along, like Tupper Saucy, who reveals things that he left out in his book, then he is made out as a Jesuit coadjutor. And Carol Quigley has the quote-unquote problem that he is only allowed to disclose so much information. He knows exactly what he is allowed to say and what he is not allowed to say. Certainly not allowed to say that Jesuit Georgetown, the Georgetown University in the first place was founded by John Carroll, was it, right?
Right.
A Jesuit. And he is not allowed to say that the whole American foreign policy is actually fomented at Jesuit Georgetown University. So by that you can save yourself the time of reading 1,363 pages of Tragedy and Hope and just ask yourself, why is an author that is teaching as a professor at that university, when he writes a book with that kind of an interesting title, not talking about the figures behind the curtain? And that's exactly the same thing that Edward G. Griffin didn't do. I mean, I didn't read his book, The Creature from Jekyll Island, but I'm willing to ask the same $64,000 question back to you. How often does he mention the Jesuits or the Roman Catholic Church, for that matter, in his book, The Creature from Jekyll Island?
Well, I would say that it's either one time, maybe, or none.
I even tend to none, because people like Edward G. Griffin do not go the same way that F. Capasauci did, looking up the Encyclopedia Judaica and looking up what the Rothschild stands for. The Rothschild stands in the Encyclopedia Judaica, according to the research that F. Capasauci did, and you can do that by yourself by just Googling the Encyclopedia Judaica and read it for yourself online.
It's in the book.
It's in the book.
The Jesuit Vatican conspiracy.
No, it's in the book Rules of Evil from F. Capasauci. That's what I'm talking about.
Yes, but I also, it's in the in our series.
Yeah,
of.
I know that you took the excerpt there, but my point being is that Capasauci made this inquiry on the Encyclopedia Judaica, and he found out that in that encyclopedia itself states that the Rothschilds are not anything more and also not anything less, but the guardians of the papal treasure. They are the war bankers of the Vatican. An interesting little anecdote is that the name Rothschild, as you pronounce it in English, in German spoken means Rothschild, and that is a red shield. And that is the same red shield that the pagan Roman soldiery used to defend themselves when they went into battle. You know, when you were a soldier 2,000 years ago and you went into battle, you had a shield and a sword, a shield to protect yourself and a sword to attack. And that color of that shield was red. So the color of the soldiery, of the army, of the then ruling pagan Roman Empire was red. And it is no coincidence, let me tell you, that the god of war in the Roman pagan empire was the planet Mars, M-A-R-S, the same planet that we call today the red planet, and where NASA, so-called, sends one drone after another up. I mean, if you believe that, you probably believe in Santa Claus also, but that's something on a very, very different subject. But my point being is the red planet Mars is a symbol for the Rothschilds, of Rothschilds, as you say in English. And the planet Mars spells M-A-R-S. And the company that the Rothschilds founded was called Meyer, Amschel, Rothschild und Söhne. Now, take the first letters of that. That is Meyer, M, Amschel, A, Rothschild, R, Söhne, sons, S, M-A-R-S. Do you think that there's any coincidence in this fact that I've just read to you, that I just told you here about? I don't think that it's any coincidence anyway. And this is that kind of research that Edward G. Griffin and a lot of other so-called truthers in the so-called truther scene are not going to touch. Because if they would touch it, they would probably be JFK'd.
It's the conspiracy direction. And it's religion that runs the world.
Yeah, but you are not allowed to point in the direction. You're only allowed to point in the misdirection. And that is exactly what Edward G. Griffin does.
That's exactly. And also, he mentions the left and the right. I want to quote, "The right and left wing of party politics are both wings of the same bird. The head of the bird determines the directions, not the wings. And the head of the bird is the Jesuits."
And that's what he leaves out.
And that's what he leaves out.
Absolutely.
It's not what he's saying.
It's what he's not saying.
It's not what Alex Jones is saying. It's not what Eric Phelps is saying. It's not what the Hagmans are saying. It's not what Quayle says, and all the reptilian book writers, it's what they leave out.
You forgot David.
And we're not leaving out the word Jesuit. They want to leave that word Jesuit out of the vocabulary. It's part of history. We have a Jesuit coming to speak at a joint session of Congress on September 23rd, 2015. This is not a conspiracy. It is a conspiracy, but it's no theory. The Pope is coming. So, you know, I'd like to start the next I got two more clips. I'd like to play this another clip. It's only 5 minutes, so I'm going to start that clip right now.
So how does that apply to the Tea Party movement that we see today? There it is. I mean, that's the blueprint. The Tea Party movement seems to have been a very genuine, spontaneous movement arising from people who were unhappy with both the Bush administration and the candidacy of Obama. They didn't like either one of them. They were people who understood, more or less, maybe not intellectually and historically, that there was collectivism in both parties, but they understood that something wasn't right, and they didn't want more of the same. And so the Tea Party movement, you know, based, just think about it. What does that mean? It goes back to the historical episode where the colonists in Boston dumped the Tea Party into the Boston Bay because it was a protest against the taxes and the restriction of liberties and the Stamp Act and so forth on the part of Great Britain against the colonies. And so the Tea Party movement really was a rebellion against big government, no matter what camp it came from, whether it came from the Republicans or the Democrats. Well, it didn't take long, especially when the Tea Party movement began to gain momentum, and I was privileged to see that because I was invited to participate in some of these early events. And I remember the first event I went to, maybe they had a couple hundred people, but they were all, you know, dedicated to the principles that made this country great. It had nothing to do with Republicans or Democrats. It had to do with political philosophy, the concept of limited government and the people being in charge, not the government in charge. So I saw it start in a small fashion like that. And then over the next couple of years, it grew and grew and grew until finally it was a very large movement. And at this point, the political parties, the leadership of the political parties began to take very careful note of it. And they said, wait a minute, this is something we should be doing, because they're experts at orchestrating movements and letting the people think that it's their movement, you see. This was a genuine, grassroots, spontaneous movement. Had nothing to do in the beginning with political parties. Well, the leadership of the parties couldn't let that be. So they both looked at it very carefully, and the Democrats decided that because of the nature and the slogans and so forth, it didn't fit well. So they began to attack it. They began to try and make it look like it was a bunch of idiots and wackos and tin hat people and all this sort of thing. And the Republicans thought, this is something we can use. And so they started to go into it as best they could and take it over. That was their goal, to co-opt it for their program. And well, so here we are today looking at this process underway. They're still trying very hard to convert the Tea Party movement into a Republican front. And I'm sorry to say that they have achieved some success in that direction, primarily because of some very well-known people who are closely aligned with the Republican Party. We're talking about the candidate, of course, Sarah Palin, who is a Republican from top to bottom, and she represents this right-wing image. She fills the bill perfectly. She's the Miss Republican right-wing collectivist, and she can speak with great fervor and great emotion and great meaning against the extremes of the Democrats, those bad left-wingers, and she does a good job of it, and everything she says is true. But she doesn't speak out against those bad right-wingers, you see, because she's part of that group. Her mission is not to bring about a restoration of the principles of America, but to get the Republicans back into power. That's her mission. And, of course, we have people like Glenn Beck, who have the power of the Fox broadcasting system behind him. That's tremendous power. And he's always speaking against those bad left-wing Democrats with great conviction and great fervor and great truth. Nothing wrong with what he says. What's wrong is what he doesn't say.
Let's keep in mind that Fox News is owned by Rupert Murdoch, a Knight of Malta.
He'll never attack somebody from the Republican Party. We've got people like Rush Limbaugh, plays the same role. He's very good at exposing the Democrats. He's very good at pointing out the absurdity of the left-wing philosophy, but he'll never say anything bad about a right-winger or a Republican. So there you have it. Of course, on the Democrat side, you've got the same team. You know, these are the cheerleaders and the players. They work together. And the average voter gets caught in the middle of this. He hasn't any idea what's going on. He just thinks that the debate is such that he has to choose. What are you, who are you going to vote for? Are you going to vote Republican or are you going to vote Democrat? And so as long as they're in that role, they're like a tennis ball in a tennis match. They get hit back and forth across the net. First they're on the right, bing, then they're back on the left, bing, back they're on the right. They're Republican, they're Democrat. And the game goes on and on and on. And although it's possible for the players of that game to win, the tennis ball never wins that game. So I think it's time for people to stop being tennis balls in this game and just get out of the game completely.
Jörg, I mentioned, he mentions the press.
Mm-hmm.
And give me a little definition of what a Knight of Malta is.
Well, first of all, I want to say this were 5 minutes where the pot was calling the kettle black. he accuses Rupert Murdoch of not telling the whole truth. It's about what it's not about what he says, but it's about what he doesn't say. Well, this is exactly the same according to him, right?
Exactly.
So this is the pot calling the kettle black. And this is exactly the same thing that he does, what he accuses other people of, being the tennis ball, being pushed from the left to the right, from the right to the left, back and forth. And that's exactly what he is doing. And about his political party analysis there, you have the Democrats on the left, you have the Republicans on the right, and then you have the Tea Party movement. Calling that a grassroots movement, if that is a grassroots movement, then I don't want to be part of a grassroots movement, because that's as grassroots movement as the Democrats and the Republicans are. It's just a third party they throw in there to put more distraction on it. People who came out of this so-called grassroots movement, if I'm not completely mistaken, are people like Ron Paul. How many times has Ron Paul been to Rome? Ron Paul has been speaking at Georgetown University. Is anybody ever talking about that?
No, because the word Jesuit is not in their vocabulary.
And not even the word Jesuit, even the word Roman Catholic Church, or Catholicism, or the Pope. Or even worse, you said the Pope is coming this year, September 23rd, to the United States of America to speak before a joint session of Congress on behalf of the American people, right? He's
right.
Not just a pope. He is not just a Jesuit. He is a Jesuit antichrist.
He is
the biblical, historical, and prophetic antichrist coming to a so-called Protestant nation to speak on the behalf of the so-called Protestant inhabitants.
And before seven.
That is something that has to be covered. He is playing exactly the same game that he accuses Rupert Murdoch of. And you said Rupert Murdoch is a Knight of Malta, and you want me to go deep into the Knight of Malta? Well, I can only say, Walt, I want to make this short, because otherwise we are still at midnight talking here about this. I made a very interesting video about 2 or 2.5 hours long when I was on the broadcast on Nothing But the Truth, Michael Adams. And we did a broadcast for more than 2 hours on the power of the Sovereign Military Order of Malta. And what and who do they all control in this world? And to make it short for the people who have no idea what the Knights of Malta are, the Knights of Malta are a military religious order from the Vatican that control banking and food and politics all over the world on behalf of the Antichrist, to make it that simple. If you want to have any more information on that, go to my YouTube channel, Dr. 66, look up in the playlists of Nothing But the Truth, and you will find that video as one of the first 6 videos that I've uploaded in that series. It's a broadcast from begin this year or the end of last year. I don't remember anymore. And there you will learn much more than we can talk about now in 5 minutes about the Knights of Malta. But these Knights of Malta are the same Knights of Malta that also the Rothschilds are part of. Meyer Anschel Rothschild was a Knight of Malta. So he was a papal knight. And that was another point that Tapasorsi made in his book. Who would expect an Orthodox Jewish family to be behind the banking affairs of the Roman Catholic Church? Nobody. And this leads directly back to the title of your show today, The Conspiracy of Misdirection, because everybody is pointing their finger to the Jews, to the Zionists. And they are leaving out, or better said, the people are being so indoctrinated with this kind of quote-unquote knowledge that they do not any further search on where do these come from, who is behind that. You know, when you're going to a theater and you're watching a performance in a theater, you have a curtain there. And sometimes you have two curtains or three curtains. So well, when you split the first curtain and you are faced with another curtain, then it would be stupid to say, oh, I'm a theater and there's another curtain and that's all right and there they do their play. No, you have to open the second curtain also. And if there's a third curtain, you have to open the third curtain also to see who is actually behind it all. And that's what all these people do not do. They show you the curtain, do not tell you who is behind it.
That's
and
right.
Sometimes when they reveal the first curtain and push it open, and you are faced with the second, they say, oh, and that's it, and they don't go any further. And it is up to you, listener, it is up to you to do your own research and to see and to get really to the bottom of this.
Okay.
That's what no one of the people that we mentioned here right now actually is doing. And that is called the conspiracy of misdirection. They know that you know something, and they lead you into the direction that they want you to. They lead you into the direction, oh, it's the bankers, it's the Jews, it's the Zionists, it's this and this, but they never go to the bottom of the conspiracy, and that's the point I make.
And they sell lots of books.
Yeah, of course.
Lots of books. And
of course,
if you want to get a free book that's got all the answers in 110
pages.
That's
what they are paid for, Walt. That's what they are paid for.
That's,
you know,
that's right.
Some press made a very good broadcast on that, on Nothing But the Truth, on the subject of flattery. And that brings it all to the point that it's that flattery. When you do that, you get rewarded. So when you write all these books, okay, you're going to get rewarded because these books are going to be sold. And if they're not going to be sold, you're going to be paid anyway because you do it, because you work for our agenda.
And you know, now we're getting down to some time here. I got one more clip that I want to play.
Sorry, it'll take so much time.
No, it's fine. We got plenty of time. No, that was good. G. Edward Griffin makes some very interesting comments, and I just put some voices with it in this last clip. In other words, when you see a Democrat Republic. They always, a Republican, a Democrat, you know, they act like they're debating. But there's some issues that they're 100% all on board. And so let's let Edward Griffin explain this.
There are certain issues that people on the left and the right in American politics will never discuss. And the reason they won't discuss them is because they agree mutually. The Democrats and the Republicans agree on something, so they don't want to talk about it in public debate because it reveals the fact that they're basically the same. They only talk about things on which they disagree. Turns out that the things on which they agree are the most important things. The things in which they disagree are relatively minor. So the things in which they agree are, for example, our foreign policy. They both agree that the desired goal eventually is to move the United States into world government.
Ladies and gentlemen, Pope John Paul II.
I have come here to pay homage to Mahatma Gandhi, hero of humanity. Mahatma Gandhi told that if all men and women, whatever the differences between them, cling to the truth with respect for the unique dignity of every human being, a new world order, a new world order, a civilization of love can be achieved.
Not just any world government, but a world government based on the model of collectivism. In other words, big, powerful, centralized world government.
Mr. President, final question.
Yes, sir.
You said famously, when you looked into Vladimir Putin's eyes, you saw his soul.
Yeah.
When you look into Benedict XVI's eyes, what do you see?
God.
When you look into Benedict XVI's eyes, what do you see?
God.
If it were a world government based on the principles of freedom and freedom of choice, freedom of culture.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States on September 11th, 1991.
And tonight, we lead the world in facing down a threat to decency and humanity. What is at stake is more than one small country. It is a big idea, a new world order. A new world order where diverse nations are drawn together in common cause.
That was George Bush Sr. explaining the new world order.
Low intervention, if no intervention in the lives of normal human beings, it might be a wonderful thing, but that's not the kind of world government the left and the right have in mind.
Ladies and gentlemen, from Washington, D.C., at the Kennedy Center on C-SPAN, President Bill Clinton.
And after 1989, President Bush said, and it's a phrase that I often use myself, that we needed a new world order, that we needed a new world order, and instead it looks like we got a lot of disorder.
They're talking about total world government, with all major decisions being made at the top, and people at the bottom being essentially living in a feudalist society, just serfs.
Yes, the feudal system, that was the old world order, ruled by the Holy Roman Empire. And who ruled the Holy Roman Empire? It was the Roman Catholic Church. And here's Jesuit Joe Biden ushering in the old world order.
The affirmative task we have now is to actually create a new world order, a new world order, because the global order is changing again.
Peasants, basically, in a high-tech feudalism. And the left and the right both agree with that goal, and so they never discuss it in public debate.
Yes, they do discuss it, but it's not up for debate. Yes, the Vatican Jesuit global conspiracy is right out in plain sight. And here is Vice President Jesuit Joe Biden.
I believe we, and particularly you, your class, has an incredible window of opportunity to lead in shaping a new world order for the 21st century. A new world order for the 21st century. In a way consistent with American interest and the common interest.
And what he means by the New World Order, they're just ushering in the Old World Order.
Do you have any comments, York?
Oh, I think all my comments would go much farther than the few minutes that we still have on this.
Yes.
First of all, I want to mention that all these people that just were speaking about a new world order there are just conspiracy theorists. And you know why? When you Google new world order and you go to Wikipedia, it says new world order and then in brackets conspiracy theory. So Joe Biden, Clinton, Bush, the Pope, they are all conspiracy theorists, because according to Wikipedia, which is one of the, if not the most used encyclopedia on the internet nowadays, declares New World Order as a conspiracy theory. So they are all in the same boat with 9/11 deniers or 9/11 truthers or whatever you want to call them. Right?
Right.
That's the first important point that I want to make. Second important point I want to make is G. Alfred Griffin said that the party leaders of the Democratic and the Republics only talk about the things that they do not agree on, because the most important points they do agree on, and they don't discuss these. So, Edward G. Griffin, my question to you is, when they agree on the most important points, first of all, what are these most important points? And second of all, how come they agree on the most important points? Maybe because they are guided by the same power behind them? Isn't that a question anybody should ask themselves? Because when you today look at the United States, or I for my part here in Belgium, and that is a question that I often ask people when I visit people with doing my job, and we go to talk about politics, I say, 30 years ago you had a left-wing government, 20 years away you had a right-wing government, then you had a left-wing government. Can you tell me where something essentially changed during one of these governments anyway in their politics? And they never can answer. They say, no, actually never. Something changed here and there a little, but the overall policy is always the same. And that's the same for you people in the United States of America, whether you have a Democratic president or you have a Republican president. The overall policy never changes. Why? Because the people behind the Democrats and the Republicans are the same. And they agree on the same most important points. So then it is absolutely futile to go vote for either right or left. And what do a lot of people say? Well, my vote doesn't count for many anyway, but I'm going to vote for Republican, then I'm going to at least choose the lesser of two evil. Well, why don't you go and choose the right way instead of the more comfortable one of the wrong ways? And what's the right way, Walt?
Right way is
Jesus Christ.
Is Jesus Christ.
Choose Jesus Christ and not the Antichrist. Because you can vote whether Republican or Democrat or Tea Party or whatever, you always choose a candidate of the Antichrist, and you never choose Christ. And Christ has been taken out of your lives, and we have been on many broadcasts saying these. One of the broadcasts was externalization of the hierarchy by taking out the morning prayers in 1963 out of American schools, taking God out of the life of children.
And we're getting down to the time we got. And this all boils back. I mean, it all leads back to 1776, because what we see here amplified now in 2015 with the visit of the Pope. In 1776, the Roman Catholic Church had no civil rights, no civil power, and they had no religious rights. I mean, England had suppressed them. The biggest lie, I only got 30 seconds, is the fact that this country, the founders of this country, were Christians. They were not Christians. This country, and it doesn't wash good. It's a hard pill to swallow, but this country was Catholic from 1776, and now they totally control America. And proof of it is in September 23rd, 2015. The Pope is coming to speak to a joint session of Congress. So with that, we'll see you on the next broadcast. Bye for now.